So the reality is that you, well, depends how smart, how efficient you work as a group. But the chances are you might not quite get to the finished product stage today. You'll get a sense of where it is you're going. Yeah? You might, as long as you keep it simple and you work kind of, you share jobs out better between the groups and people are kind of working in parallel rather than series. You might manage, but we're being ambitious. I thought it was worth doing today to try and introduce this. Normally, when I do this with BGC students in the past, we've taken a day to do this, you know, so you see the difference. We see about 3 hours of that. So, but let's have a look. It's quite common in schools to say, this is what last year's year one will be. And that can be really rich because it kind of grows expectations. But you also have the opposite effect. It kind of close down, oh, that's what he wants us to say. You know? Particularly if you bring out, this is a really good one from last year, I brought around my own. So there are kind of pros and cons to showing other people's work. But I'm going to have a little look at some responses. I want to talk a bit about design decisions, okay? And so, those are the possible briefs. So, quite open. Illuminated mask, use the sort of play. Okay? But I mean, it could be any kind of mask, it depends what the play is. It could be a ball mask, very classical play, it could be an old business production mask, visualization. Or a body of the walls. Okay? All kinds of things can come out of body of the walls. In fact, people make arm guards with flashing lights on them and want to take down some clothing. You know, bracelets and necklaces and headsets, and, I mean, all kinds of things. Again, it's a very broad set of territory. Okay? And I want you to respond, you know, I want you to be creative. This is the creative bit of the course, right? It's about electronics and being creative. So you get kids to think wider about the kind of exciting things that they might do, given the technology they have. I'll show you the technology I'm going to give you in a minute, but you know, you can have switches and LEDs basically. It's a substrate. Here's an example of quite a basic response to the mask project. Okay, you've got a stick, you've got a flat mask, you've got a battery pack, you've got a folded case. We're going to be using polypropylene. I don't know if people use polypropylene, so it's a fantastic material. Plastic, that you can kind of score it and bend it and shape it and punch it, just like you can cards. It's like using cards as one material. Often in schools, people do this with cards because it's cheaper than polypropylene. Polypropylene gives you a nice professional feel. Finished the product, so we tend to use that. You can see that there's a stick with a battery bottle, so we switch some lights on. That's a very simple response. I think, I'm not sure if in the version of PowerPoint I've left for you, there might be some examples of these made up products. I can't remember now, but I have got a version of these made up. So here's a more kind of sophisticated response. You put a bit of curve into your card, it's not just a flat card, it's something that's going to curve around your face, these straps on. So you can see that from a design point of view, that's a more complicated thing to make. The response. The electronics are very little different to that. You've still got a switch and battery and some lights. Okay, a more advanced response. Might be to not just do more interesting things with masks, but also if you look at the left there, more interesting things with the electronics. So you've got different parts in different places, switch on and off and different switches. Yeah? Okay? So those are the kind of directions of difficulty that you can kind of build kids along. And as your teachers know this, for those who aren't all learning, that in a different group, you have different groups with different levels. Accept some kids will work very basically, that might be great for them. Other kids will be challenging them to work at this level, and that's what it's good. And then you can let kids work at different levels and then have the roof ideas. And you're still, I mean, the actual cost of the two projects you're seeing there aren't vastly different, are they? They're still similar amounts of materials, similar amounts of electronics. So, in terms of whether you're keeping the cost down, you're going to be happy. Because you can say to kids, you can have up to this number of components, you can have this amount of material, you can have, you know. So, that's how we limit things at schools. Children and the amount of material to use. It's that much of a risk. As I say, I'm using my program, we can make a car, use all kinds of sort of thing. Then what? I mean, it's, who was saying they were the tax loss? This could be a tax loss project, quite easily. It looks more like a graphic product, stroke as a particular product, because that's where I've come from to it. But I see no reason why this could be known as a tax loss project. It's about a chance of benefit. That's all. I'm not got tax loss in specifically today, but it could be. But one of the issues, and some of you have seen this before, particularly on my course, you've seen this before, but one of the things you need to think about children is where they make the design decisions. A mate of mine, Ben Rolex, who some of you have seen across, that's my name, you're has made the point that if you get to the end of the project with 20 to 25 kids, and you lay them all out on the table and take photos of them, yeah, and put them up on the screen, and they all look the same. You know, it's their photographs, put them out on the table, but they all look the same. You've got to ask the question about how much design has been done. How many design decisions are children going to make if they're all the same? Whereas if you put some kids' projects out there and push everyone look different, that's some kind of metric that says kids have done some creative work, they've made their own decisions. It's all not just based on what the teachers tell you to do. And they did this analysis, where he said, well, what are the design decisions that children need to make? One of them is that what it does, yeah, kind of concept. But in a sense, that's actually the one that we almost always give children. In fact, I've just given you a choice or two, but I've given you the kind of what it does is going to ask you. Well, there's quite a lot of flexibility in that, but a lot of what it does is giving you. How it works. Again, very often at Transfer Stage 3, particularly, and even Stage 4, we tie that down to design with kids. And actually, if kids are doing electronics and using electronics as a product material, in D&T, they're going to be making decisions about the tech aspects of that. Otherwise, really, it's a graphics or a textiles or a research project with a bit of electronics overlay. Unless they're making a technical decision, that's how they're going to do D&T in that material. Aesthetic decisions, that's where it's all like in schools, it has to be said. You know, I may be caricaturing, you can tell your school's a bit different, I'll be lighter. But all four schools, you'll see the exact same thing again. Where the decision making is, what shapes and why, what colour are on the background. And that's quite a low level decision making. But actually, kids have been making decisions more sophisticated than year 5 and 6 in many primary schools. We all know more than many primary schools. But it's an important set of decisions to make. How it fits together, how's it going to be made? Their decisions of children should be making. They'll need supporting propositions, and who's it going to be for? So, and the point is that it's pretty hard. I mean, here's a challenge for you to think about it back now. Think of design decisions that children might need to make about product they're designing that doesn't fit to one of those categories. Pretty much anything you think of that you might need to make a decision fits into one of those categories. That pretty much covers the field. And over Key Stage 3, would it be great if you can announce it to your curriculum and said, over Key Stage 3, where are children making these decisions? They're not going to make all those decisions all the time, it's just not practical, okay? But over a key stage, they might, aren't they? There might be one project that you said like this, what is it that you want to make the top decision? Here's some materials that we're going to use. So we might constrain the materials and say, what would you like to really make? Well, that might be quite a nice young man project, wouldn't it? It builds up some skills for them. You know, over a key stage, you could use this as an analysis tool. Where are the kids making decisions? What kind of decisions? And if you find that the only decisions they're making in your key stage 3 curriculum are aesthetic, then I would argue you might have a problem in that design that's going on in your key stage 3 curriculum. The other point about that is, of course, that these all interact with each other. Yeah? As soon as you make a decision about construction or about technical, they kind of imply they impact on each other. So designing, we know, is a very complex business. That's one of the reasons why we try and make it simple for children. And we should try and get accessible to children, but then the challenge too. You know, real designers talk about the idea of a wicked problem. You come across this idea? The idea of design is a wicked problem, an unsolvable. Design is an unsolvable situation. Design is stopped at the point where it's good enough and you can write it. Not because it's perfect. We know that as users of design. So it's a very complex business design. But we have to be upfront with kids about that. You know, here's how it works. It's difficult, but we can go for it. We can teach you. We all know the national strategy is strategies, but you might not. The teachers know the national strategy is strategies. The teachers what I want you to do is do some design, right? I want you to work in groups of three or four, right? Five tables, five groups, so grab a table between groups of three or four. And think about what it is you want to design. You have to be quite quick on this. What are we going to make? Sketch out a basic, an intermediate, and an advanced response might look like. I'll probably have a go at the intermediate or advanced one. Yeah? Just we'll start working on something with a bit of challenge. Right? And I want you to think about the design decisions you make as you go along. So you're doing a bit of an analysis of the design decisions you go through. And then develop it. Okay? And that's what we're going to do between now, it's 11:30, and about 12:30. So you've got 2 hours really. And over that time, we need lunch too. I did say on the, I think, well, since they're now paying, we're going to have a working lunch. Lunch will arrive. We'll keep working through lunch here. So, anyway, it's a working lunch for 4 hours. So, you've got a couple of hours to see what you can do with this. Does that make sense? Yeah? We'll finish a bit before two, just time enough to see where we're up to and what we've done. Now, one of the things you have to worry about, okay, you have to accept this, you're probably only going to be able to make one of these, whatever you're making within a group. And that's going to be a bit frustrating for some of you, because you can go, oh, I'll take a room. I just raised this as an issue up front. You can start weeping quietly back outside now and get over it. Because that's the way it's going to be, right? Right, come down here, let me talk about the skills, and then I'm going to make sure you're there.